Good morning. I call this meeting of the Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee to order. It's June 21st, 2022. And I'd like to begin by acknowledging that we are on Treaty 1 territory, the home and traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Innu, and Dakota peoples, and in the national homeland of the Red River Métis. Our drinking water comes from Shoal Lake 40 First Nation and Treaty 3 territory. I'm Councillor Debbie Sharma, and I'll be chairing today's meeting. Also in the chamber is Councillor Vivian Santos, Councillor Ross Eady, our clerk, Mr. Peter Prinsloo, and planner, Mr. Rackhair.
Madam Chairperson, I'll move that the minutes of the May 31st Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee meeting be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Delegations, Mr. Clerk?
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. First, we have Inspector Leeds registered. However, he has indicated that he is unable to attend today due to work commitments out of town. So we can go straight to Brendan Salico from Landmark Planning and Design, who is here to speak to item number 3, which is the plat approval, northeast corner of McPhillip Street and North Point Boulevard.
Thank you. Mr. Clerk, just before we begin, are we able to take the folks off the screen that are not presenting at this time?
Yes, absolutely. Okay.
Thank you. Brendan, welcome.
Thank you. Good to be here. Test.
Go ahead.
Okay. All right. My name is Brendan Salico. I'm a partner and planner at Landmark Planning and Design. And before we get started, just want to thank the committee, the administration, the clerks, and those who are here in delegation today for this item and others. So here today, we want to present on North Point Center, the phase one plan approval in terms of our project team, Whiteline Real Estate. They're a local Winnipeg developer, and they're seeking plan approval for this first phase of development. Our firm, Landmark Planning and Design, we led the planning and engagement process for the site. Namark Architects designed the phase one commercial site plan and buildings, and Dean Spearman led the landscape planning. So in terms of the site context, North Point Center is approximately 44 acres in area. It's made up of two blocks bisected by North Point Boulevard, just to the east of McPhillips. This phase one plan approval is only for a 6.75 acre parcel at the northeast corner of the intersection of McPhillip Street and North Point Boulevard. You can see the site there in as phase one in red. So as part of our planning process, of course, we looked to the policies of the North Point Village Precinct Plan. There's a variety of policies and objectives and guidelines that help guide a project like this one. And so some of those policies speak to establishing a new mixed-use area. This site is designated as commercial mixed use in the plan. It talks about creating a commercial destination that not only serves the local and regional shopping needs, but those of current and future residents as well. It talks about providing a mix of land uses in an efficient way to help achieve a walkable and pedestrian-friendly development, which was key here. It also speaks to providing employment opportunities and proximity to residential areas like Highland Point to the north, which is just developing now, and Aurora directly to the east, and then finally creating a safe, efficient, and effective transportation network for all users. I would just note that we worked very closely with the planner, Mr. Hare, and his team. We provide a lot of important feedback during the planning process, which we were able to incorporate into the plan, and I think that's noted well in the planner's report, which of course we agree with. Just briefly, in terms of our approach to public consultation and stakeholder engagement, so we began a process back in December of 2021 where we met with some adjacent and nearby residents to try to get input kind of for the larger sites, so not just phase one, but the overall North Point Center site. We just went out last week for a second round to share these plans, which we think were very well received by the community. I think that we'll continue to reach out and to meet with them once the future phases are conceptualized and presented, and that'll be either later this year or in subsequent years. So just briefly to touch on the plan itself, so we've got kind of north to the right side of the page here, North Point Boulevard is on the left and McPhillips is on the top of the page. So as you can see here, there are six buildings. So building one would be a two-story building, which Whiteland would like to have their offices on the second floor and some commercial retail units on the main floor. Buildings 2, 3, 4, and 5 are also similar, a variety of CRUs, which could accommodate various retail service and amenity uses. And then a financial institution in the corner, the southwest corner of this site. So basically directly at that intersection with McPhillips and North Point Boulevard. I think a few things to note here are that the site is very well accessed by both pedestrians and cyclists through the existing AT paths and sidewalks, very well connected. All the buildings, if you can see my cursor, oh, my cursor's not showing up on there, so don't worry about that. But all the buildings are connected with sidewalks. Additional sidewalks were added in discussions with planning. The site is very well landscaped, so trees, shrubs, prairie grasses, kind of are around the whole periphery of the site, access off North Point Boulevard, as well as off McPhillips. There are several pedestrian kind of seating areas around the site. Garbage is taken care of via Moloch Bin, which are kind of these in-ground, underground garbages, a bit cleaner than the kind of dumpsters with, you know, wooden enclosures. There's bike racks. There's a lot of accessible parking. And then one thing that we think is, you know, really nice about the site is that generally the parking's enclosed, you know, in the middle of all the buildings, rather than kind of being a big sea of parking right at the corner of that that prime intersection there. So just in terms of the renderings, I'll just share these briefly. So this is a view of building number one, looking towards the northeast. So you can see again on the second floor, Whiteland hopes to have their offices and you know, an outdoor patio, and then commercial retail units on that main floor. Here's a view looking north, directly from North Point Boulevard. So you can see some of those pedestrian connections, some of that landscaping. You can see the first building, which I believe would be the first to be built, out in the kind of background there towards the north. Here's a view from the parking lot itself. So again, there would be landscaping not only on the periphery of the site, but also within the parking lot as well, very accessible. Here's a view of CRUs 5 and 1. So this is kind of looking towards the northwest, and then just a few final images here. So on the left, looking towards the west, towards that McPhillips North Point intersection, that's the future financial institution. On the top right of the page, we're looking from McPhillips towards phase one. So that would be, again, that first building. And then on the bottom right of the page, we see kind of a view from the parking lot looking south towards North Point Boulevard. In terms of this color scheme, fits with Whiteland's colors, so some accents in red and then some kind of slate gray, white, and black. Very sharp. Just in terms of some of those landscape considerations, so again, prairie grasses, shrubs, trees kind of throughout and within the site, some ornamental fencing to match what's already there on the sign that says Aurora right at McPhillips and North Point Boulevard. As noted, a few seating areas with benches, be well landscaped and well shaded. So a lot of thought went into this landscape plan in keeping with the guidelines in the plan and discussions with planning. So that's it in a nutshell. Thank you very much for your consideration on this item, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have about the site.
Okay, thanks very much, Brendan. Any questions from my colleagues?
Just there's a lot of connections from within the neighborhood. What kind of, can you just quickly go over again the pedestrian cycling connections, say, off of McPhillips?
Yeah, for sure. So there's three pedestrian connections directly off the sidewalk off of North Point. So kind of one right at the intersection where the private road will come in, yeah. And then two in the interior. So one between building 3 and 4. And then one between building 4 and the financial institution. Yeah. Our understanding is that eventually there will be either an active transportation pathway or a sidewalk directly along McPhillips. And then at that point, we actually already have anticipated that in between building or between buildings 1 and 5, we already do have a pedestrian connection that is accessing McPhillips for when that pathway on city land is eventually built. So very, very well connected, not only outside of the site, but also within the site.
So I haven't been out that way on McPhillips, but McPhillips isn't fully, like, the sidewalks and that haven't been built out there yet. It's still like a...
Yeah, I believe that on the kind of on the west side of our site, on the east side of McPhillips, that it hasn't been built kind of to its final standard yet. That is something that I believe with kind of all the development that's been happening in the area and some of these developments, that it will be something that I think will be coming soon, and we'll be connecting to that when it's there. But for now, three connections directly to North Point Boulevard, one very close to the intersection of McPhillips and North Point Boulevard.
Really close? Okay. All right. Thank you.
No problem.
Brendan, there is very good pedestrian connectivity within the pad site. That's really important to myself, and I know this committee. So thank you for that detail and for working with our planner on that. In terms of garbage receptacles, you do have the underground system, and you have outdoor seating that you've displayed here on the plan. What about adding some garbage receptacles for the public as they walk by and, you know, want to throw out their empty drink container?
Yeah, that's a really good point. You know, the Moloch bins, kind of as you noted, those are more kind of for the businesses themselves to use. They kind of replace the dumpsters, so it would make sense to have kind of your, you know, smaller ones at those kind of three key seating areas, the two that are kind of close to North Point Boulevard, and then the one that's closer to the corner of McPhillips there. So that's something I think that we'd definitely be open to having as a condition.
Thank you. So when we get to the item, I will ask the planner to draft up an amendment to that effect, because we do get the complaints after the fact, yeah, when there's litter along the main roadway there. Mm-hmm. Okay. And what kind of feedback did you get from residents during your stakeholder engagement?
Yeah, so, you know, when we started the stakeholder engagement process late last year, we were kind of discussing the overall site. So we had a lot of folks from Aurora at North Point, some of them on Atlas Crescent, who just had concerns or were wondering, you know, what's going to be behind our backyards. And I think that's kind of what we heard kind of loud and clear, you know, considerations for context sensitivity, things like height, things like privacy, landscaping. I think for this site, you know, because that was the focus of this latest round of engagement, we heard a lot of positives. Folks that said, hey, we've been living in Aurora now for a few years. It would be great to have some commercial and retail amenities that we can walk to, that we can bike to, that we can, you know, head to with our families. So I think this site itself was very well received. And as noted, we'll continue to engage residents as future phases come online.
You noted a patio, second level patio, building one. Okay. Are there any, you know, there may be coffee shops, various restaurants coming online later. I'm sure you don't know all that detail yet, but will there be any outdoor patio, and when will we see that detail? Would that be at a later time, or have you contemplated that yet?
Yeah, so that was one of the things, you know, it's always this chicken and an egg when we're working on kind of a larger plan approval before, you know, maybe before there's demand for, you know, certain types of tenants, or before there's been negotiations or discussions. So I think that the intent is that it would be great to have a restaurant here. And if there were to be a restaurant, I think a patio would definitely be considered, whether that, you know, is rejigging a couple parking spots or using some of that green space area to make one. And then we would have to come back to this committee again for an additional plan approval.
Where do you potentially see that happening? Which building?
It's hard to say at this point. You know, I think the buildings have been designed to have some flexibility with those CRUs. So I think that right now they're all kind of standard size, but they can be kind of enlarged or made smaller to accommodate if there were kind of a tenant that wanted to locate here. So it's hard to say exactly which building it might be in.
The spaces are built to suit depending on who comes forward.
That's right. That's right. There's flexibility in the build.
I think it would be nice to, you know, attract a tenant that would have a patio availability for the public. I think we're lacking some of those amenities in our area.
Mm-hmm.
So something to keep an eye out on.
For sure.
Councillor Reedy, did you have a question?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Thought I saw your hand. All right. Anything else you'd like to add?
No, I would just say that, you know, we're very excited about this proposal. It seems like the community as well, I hope, you know, with Highland Point and with Aurora kind of growing, this could be kind of a community hub for, you know, various retailers and various commercial uses. So like, it's a great news story for this community, and excited to kind of follow it and see it get built.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Chairperson, kind of growing? Kind of.
This could be our full-time focus.
Sorry.
Definitely. Development is booming in our area. Mm-hmm. The accessible stalls, they're sprinkled throughout the site. Sometimes when snow falls, you can't see the marking on the ground. There are other applications that you can use to denote the accessible stall. You'll be looking at those kinds of things.
Yeah, for sure. And actually, one of the things that we had some discussions with the planner as well, with some of those markings for the crosswalk areas as well. So even where the sidewalks cross,
right,
to make sure that it's not just, you know, kind of painted on with paint that'll, you know, be gone in a couple of years, some, you know, brick inlays and things like that,
right,
to really demarcate where those crossings are. So accessibility was something that the architects definitely paid close attention to in the site design.
Excellent.
Great. Thank you, and appreciate you reaching out to my office. We've had discussions. I've also given feedback to the planner. We talk regularly on files that are before us, so thank you for your collaboration and your work. We will add the amendment on the garbage receptacles later today. I'll put it forward. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
And please continue to engage me on the next next development of the site.
For sure.
Okay, next, Mr. Clerk.
Our next delegate is Mr. David Hill from the Streetside Development Corporation, to be heard with respect to plan approval 20 Lynch Street, which is report 5 on our agenda today. Good morning, David. Please start your video and unmute yourself, and you'll have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation.
Thank you very much. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can.
Yeah. David, are you putting your video on? There you go.
Okay. Thanks for having me join you today. I'll just give a brief summary of our proposal for our multifamily development at the corner of Link Street and Murray Avenue. It's a townhome development, two-story wood frame townhomes, 54 units. And laid out in 7 buildings. And I think we've got a pretty good layout. I hope I could share the plan with you. But I won't get stuck with the technical side of that. Just explain that we devote a lot of attention to the street presence, street view on Link Street, with landscaping and our connected sidewalks in, at those positions. We've got full-length driveways for this development, and which means we have quite a bit of parking, more than that's normally required for a multifamily site like this. Some of the other features of the plan are a major connecting sidewalk in the middle that connects with that. I believe it's a future active pathway on Link Street. The homes themselves, or the townhomes, have small private backyards and optional privacy fences that turned out quite popular on our the sister project, which is nearing completion at 388 Pipeline Road. So we're pretty optimistic that this will be as well received as the original project on Pipeline. The variances involved are two side variances in the front setback from Link Street. We've got a full 25-foot backyard to the adjoining single-family homes on the north west side. And I'm available for any questions about the development. I've had some discussions already with the planner and councillor, but I'm totally happy to address any concerns or questions now.
Okay, David, thank you. Questions? All right. David, just looking at the plans here, thank you for your presentation. The buildings in the center, 28 and 36, I guess that building?
Yes.
Yeah. There isn't, how does the fencing work backing onto the owner's property? Is that optional or is that likely going to be put up?
Yeah, we found that there's a good proportion of people have liked this idea. It's a low privacy fence. It's not meant as a big property line fence. It's mainly to keep children and pets in the yard. And the dimensions are a modest size. They're 20 feet by 20 feet. And as I said, when our sister project on pipeline, we saw that a good majority of people opted for this optional fence, but some people just preferred to have an open backyard that was open to the next door neighbor. So on those two interior buildings, we foresee a lot of the people putting in these optional fences and, you know, being able to enjoy that area. There is a retention. It's designed, the grade plan is intended to hold water in the event of heavy downpours. The middle section there is designed as a retaining area for land drainage. Mm-hmm. The side facing Link Street has quite a bit of landscape screening, and we've got a low 4-foot fence.
Yeah. So, David, the question, like, so the fences, you anticipate the side yard will have a fence through, or may not, right? That's your choice.
The backyards have the choice of the optional fence, but there is a 4-foot developer fence. It's more or less a decorative fence that does screen the or denote the boundary to Link Street. And that's a kind of a decorative feature.
So when you come out the backyard, the sides of the homeowner's property, they can choose whether they want a fence or not in between the neighbor. Yeah, in between the neighbor. Now, what about the back? That's again optional. Do you
normally when they purchase these, it's all three sides, so it's the two sides and the back would be included in their optional privacy fencing.
Right. Okay.
And it is because this is managed by a property manager, and the grass cutting is a corporation responsibility. There's gates in the fence to allow the landscapers to get in and out to maintain the sod and the grass in those privacy areas.
So my question is, if everyone had the back fence, how much green space is left there? And the purpose of it is for drainage. It's not flat. Does it slope in?
It does slope. It's a bowl shape. It's not a severe incline, but it is bowl shaped in that area that's designed to as an overflow to collect water and heavy downpours.
Right. Okay. And in Amber Grove, that property, do you have the same setup? I haven't been there lately. Right.
Amber Grove, it's the roadways form a lot of the holding areas for heavy downpours. And with that project, we don't really have a central area that's quite the same as this. But of course, we have these privacy fences.
Do you have the same scenario where you have building 28 and 36? Do you have that scenario in Amber Grove?
Not really. I can't say that because at Amber Grove, most of these model townhomes are facing the property line. So they're facing away from the interior. We don't really have interior models the same as this facing inside there.
Okay.
They're slightly different models that don't really incorporate a very tiny area.
Would it make sense to extend the back fence so it's a shared fence with these property owners or no?
It was original plan was to have the back fence and then there'd be long kind of backyards, but we're just wondering the benefit of that. Is it more of a burden we weren't sure if it really enhanced the site to have long, long backyards that sort of slope into the bowl. So that was the reason behind keeping these only 20 feet because now we're extending everyone's fence into a kind of bowl collection area, which we weren't too sure that was going to work very well.
So the benefit would be they would have a larger yard. However, is it usable because it's located?
Exactly, out, right? And the fence on an incline like that, we weren't sure if that was a real benefit.
Is your landscape architect with you today?
No.
Okay. All right. Is it possible to flatten out that area or no? It has to slope.
Not really. We're limited in area to hold water on the site, and it would be nice to have that area flat. We actually the original grade plan had it for an even more severe bowl, but we're putting a retaining wall in another position along the northwest property line, just so it's not quite so severe. So we've already done our very best to mitigate that middle bowl, but I think we've done about all we can to flatten that area out without creating a gigantic retaining wall on the northwest side.
Right. So it's a 20-foot backyard?
Correct.
Yeah. So then a 20-foot driveway?
Correct.
Yeah. And let's talk about that a little bit. It's important to have a 20-foot driveway opposed to a much shorter one we've seen in other places, simply to allow the car to easily park on the driveway, correct? And so we anticipate one car being in the garage, one being on the driveway. There's no parking on the internal roadways, correct?
No, there's no parking on internal roadways, and so we anticipate that the driveways are going to be used for visitor parking and the second parking spot if someone has two cars. Okay. And of course, we do have some visitor parking as well.
Do you feel the visitor parking is adequate? Because there isn't a lot of on-street parking in the area.
Yes, I think we're actually really good. We're required to have 81 under the zoning requirements. And actually, we have over 100 parking spots as it is. It's actually 108 parking, and we're only required to have 81. So we're far in excess of what the requirements are. I don't think there'll be any problems with parking on the site.
Okay, well, we hope not.
I know Amber Grove, we had an issue with the length of our driveways there. They weren't really, we didn't really envision them as driveways, more of an approach, but the reality is people are looking for more parking, and they're, yeah, unless you have a small car, that's an issue. So that was a lesson learned at Amber Grove.
Mm-hmm. Well, I appreciate that. I agree. I had recently seen it. You and I spoke offline. Yeah.
Yeah.
So if we can, you know, not go with that shorter driveway again, I think that people need to park the second vehicle. They have visitors, two cars in the home, whatever the case may be, because now they're hanging over onto the roadway into the
right,
and that's going to create a hazard. So I think the city's looking at some options there as well.
That's something for sure, and I think that situation will improve a bit once we get the main parking lot completed at Amber Grove. But I think what we learned there is an approach. It's either a driveway or an approach. You can't go halfway with that. So like a 14 or 15 foot driveway is just not, it doesn't work as well as just going straight to a 4 foot or 2 foot approach or a full 20 foot driveway. But the middle of trying to get the middle of the road there, it doesn't really work very well.
Okay. Great. Thanks, David. And I checked. The other fellow from your office did not reach out to me. So in the future, you know, it'd be great to meet with yourself and your landscape architect.
Okay.
It was a while back they reached out. I think it was last year. But just as we get closer to because it would just avoid sort of these detailed questions at this stage.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll try and make sure we're communicating early on in the planning.
What is your timeline for construction?
Well, we're looking to get started in August. We're just getting our final underground piping plan finished, and we'd like to get the roadway and underground pipes in August, and then start the first buildings in the fall.
Okay, and finishing in 2023, is it?
Yeah, I think it's going to take us slightly less than 2 years to build it out.
Yeah, 24.
It might go faster if we're avoiding some of the supply chain problems we've been experiencing and some of the issues, but if things settle down that way, we could get it finished a bit quicker. But we'll have two full-time training crews and a well well-established basement contractor working dedicated solely on this. So we don't intend to work slowly on this. We'll be going full steam ahead.
Would you be open to adding a planter near the entrance of the development on Link Street?
Certainly, yeah.
Okay, great. I will propose an amendment later with the planner. We talked about that. I think it'll beautify the area and just be nice for the surrounding neighborhood and, of course, those that live in the development. Could you have Dan Spearman maybe reach out to me as well on that?
Sure, but Dan, he isn't the landscape architect on it, but I could talk to him and reach out, but he isn't the designer for this one.
Okay, I have that written down for some reason. Okay.
No, Dan wasn't involved with the design here. Okay. We did the landscape plan internally.
Okay.
So.
He did the landscape plan internally, you're saying?
Yes.
For this site?
Yes.
Okay, wouldn't he be the one for the planter then? Who would it be?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And it's a sheet, and I'll certainly have her reach out in terms of how that's integrating with the existing landscaping. There's two monument signs at the two entrances, so I'll definitely have her reach out in terms of how we can integrate that.
Yeah. And who is that, sorry?
That's Stephanie Borchardt.
And she's internal with you?
Yes, and she's our lead designer for much of the grounds work.
Okay, that would be great, David. Thank you.
Sure.
That looks great. We need this type of housing in the area. Appreciate your group coming forward with this application.
Thank you very much.
Seeing no further questions, we'll move on. Thank you. Have a great day.
Okay, bye-bye.
So our next delegation is Brad McGregor from Richard Winthrop Development and Planning to be heard with extension of time closing of Public Lane north of 341 Scotia Street between Scotia Street and the Red River, which is report 6 on our agenda today. Also, Mr. McGregor has submitted a presentation which has been appended to the agenda. Brad, if you want to start your video, unmute your mic, and you'll have up to 10 minutes to make the presentation starting now. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. Let me share my screen here. Make sure everyone can see it there.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. So again, good morning, everyone, council, committee members, administration. My name is Brad McGregor. I'm a planner with Richard Winthrop Planning and Development, here to present on the request of extension of time on 341 Scotia Street. As mentioned, the subject is extension of time for DAV3/2020 at the subject lines of 341 Scotia Street. Richard Winthrop has been contracted to represent the current landowner who is seeking this extension of time to allow for the current flood levels to recede and allow Manitoba Land Surveyors to complete fieldwork for the land titles examination. I'll start by giving a quick overview of the surrounding area and land for those who might be unfamiliar. The subject land is located in the Seven Oaks neighborhood. Located on the east side of Scotia Street between Hartford Avenue and Perth Avenue, with Main Street farther west. To the north is Kildonan Park, and farther south is downtown Winnipeg. Immediately adjacent to the north is 345 Scotia, zoned R1M, residential single family district medium. To the south is 337 Scotia, also zoned R1M, residential single family district medium. To the east, we have the Red River. And west across Scotia are 336 to 340 Scotia, also zoned R1M, residential single family M. So zooming into the subject lands here, I've included the proposed closed right of way here. As part of the subject lands. The subject land is an interior lot with total frontage of 66.7 feet and an area of 11,390 square feet. Currently, this is also zoned R1M, residential single family. Two key highlights for this property here. The first being the approval of the closing of the public lane on the north side of the property. and that the land be deemed surplus to the city of Winnipeg. This was approved on July 23rd in 2020. And the second is the approval of the sale of the closed public lane to the current landowners, which was approved on July 8th, 2021. So to give a brief overview of the development process here, the first two steps included the closure of the public lane and the sale of the public lane. The third step would be for the Manitoba Land Surveyor to complete its on-site work and submit to the Land Titles Office. The fourth step would be for the road closure to be finalized at the Land Titles Office. And the fifth and final step would be the city processing the consolidation of the two pieces of land through DASSF 534-2022. Right now, we are in step three. The land surveyors are waiting for the Red River to recede so they can safely complete their field work. This will then be sent to the Land Titles Office for review, which would ultimately formalize the road closing and ultimately DASSF 534-2022 to consolidate the two pieces of land. It's currently sitting with the zoning officer, but it pending the completion of the site work and Mylar submission to the Land Titles Office. That's the end of my presentation here. Again, given the abnormally wet start to 2022 and high water levels, we're looking for an extension of time on DAC 3-2020 to allow the Red River to receive and allow the surveyors to complete their field work and proceed with the remaining steps. If there's any questions, I'm available at Bahira, and our contact information is up on the screen here. But I will leave a slide up here with the site if there's any further questions.
Thank you. Councillor Eady?
Yes. Actually, I'm very familiar with this property and the sale of the land. Just wanted to confirm, so there is a new owner since the whole process for the city selling this, declaring surplus, there's a new owner of the property?
Correct, yeah. The sale's not been finalized, that's the pending part, but there is a new land owner.
Right, so because there was originally a couple there and they had to, anyway, not going to get into their details, but so somebody purchased the property off of that couple, so the garage is still on. There's, I think right now there's, an agreement there where the garage is actually built on what used to be that right away?
Correct, yeah, it's, you can kind of see it just under where it says public on the image here.
Yeah.
But yeah, essentially this is a housekeeping matter here just to tie the lines together.
Yeah, okay. I heard the water was going down pretty fast this week, so. Anyway, that's all the questions I have. I don't see any problem. You're asking for a 1 year extension on this?
Yeah, the standard, the 1 year extension.
Okay, great.
Yep.
And you don't foresee any problems with land titles? Sometimes they get busy and their processing takes quite some time.
I don't, at this time I don't, but once it reaches zoning and or they complete their review process, we'd have to see, but I don't know anything at this time.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Seeing no further questions, thank you for your presentation. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Our next delegation is Daniel Gunther on behalf of the Garden City Residents Association and Friends of West Kildonan to be heard to item 9 on our agenda, which is nomination of the West Kildonan Library, 365 Jefferson Avenue, for the list of historical resources. Daniel, you'll have up to 10 minutes to make a presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. And just while we get started, if I could ask Cindy Tugwell to come on the bench as well. I see she's next. Okay. Good morning, Daniel.
Good
Welcome.
Morning. Sorry, I'm just pulling this up here. Good morning. Good morning, Councillor and Chairperson Debbie Sharma. Good morning, Councillor Rossidi. And good morning, Councillor Vivian Santos. Thank you for the opportunity to address the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee today regarding the nomination of the West Kildonan Public Library for the list of historical resources. I am thrilled that the building at 365 Jefferson Avenue has sparked immense support and engagement from citizens across Winnipeg. As co-chair of the Community Coalition, the Friends of West Kildonan Library, I am delighted to routinely hear from residents that they place great value on the design and the aesthetic quality of the West Kildonan Library, and they want it protected. In fact, many residents talking to me assumed that the building had already been recognized as a historical resource. The high level of support and community engagement conveys the importance of this particular building as a cornerstone of Northwest Winnipeg communities, and I am pleased to support and commend the motion from Councillor Eady today. After reviewing the criteria that is required to nominate a historical resource, which has been established by the City of Winnipeg, I would like to bring your attention to the key reasons why this building meets the criteria and is historically significant. Age. West Kildonan Library was constructed over 55 years ago during a period of great architectural value to Winnipeg's history. Even more importantly, this was a civic project designed and opened to celebrate Canada's Centennial of Confederation in 1967. The plaque on the front of the library proudly states that the building was erected as a permanent commemoration of the Canadian Centennial. The person. It was designed by George A. Stewart, an influential professional architect responsible for two other Winnipeg libraries, Fort Garry and St. Vitale, which I will add St. Vitale received historical designation in 2014. Mr. Stewart's design for West Kildonan Library was more ambitious and iconic due to its larger construction budget. Mr. Stewart won numerous architectural awards and served as president of the Manitoba Association of Architects and served with the Royal Architectural Institute of Canada. Mr. Stewart's design for West Kildonan Library is part of an architectural legacy and elevates Winnipeg's profile as an enriched destination for Canadian design. The context. The building's architectural style is a prominent example of modernist, also called mid-century modern, design. The style is reflected throughout the surrounding and adjacent neighborhoods, including my own, Garden City. The Winnipeg Architecture Foundation is currently leading research on Garden City and the surrounding areas, as they are considered some of the best examples of modernist residential neighborhood design in Canada. West Kildonan Library is a cornerstone of our communities and provides an important anchor for local modernist design. The building's style was designed with many hallmarks of the modernist architectural style. It features a sleek roofline, projecting William mullions, which are unique to modernist designs, wood grain millwork, and locally sourced Tindlestone. These all remain to this day. The location and the siting of the library has immense social significance and value. The corner of Power Street and Jefferson Avenue has been described as downtown West Kildonan, as it includes numerous local schools, an educational resource center, and an arena. The Jefferson Avenue thoroughfare also connects with additional levels of school, a synagogue, community amenities, and local businesses which enrich and serve our residents. The site of the library, anchoring Jefferson Avenue, connects our Northwest neighborhoods with all of these valued services. The intactness. The West Kildonan Library remains intact and has not had its original design or hallmark modernist features altered. The library has had some upgrades since opening over 50 years ago, but these are appreciated accessibility features or mechanical upgrades. A prominent feature and value of modernist architecture is its ability to adapt to the evolving needs of the community. The building still retains its original modernist design, allowing the library services housed within to be modernized. As I have just highlighted, West Kildonan Public Library is a prominent example of modernist architecture that is worthy of preservation. The building is connected to both social and local history, and the City of Winnipeg has a responsibility to recognize this value to ensure that the design can enrich and impact future generations. I encourage this committee to support the motion. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today. Our coalition, our local residents, and members of the architectural community are appreciative of these efforts to recognize and protect West Kildonan Library as a historical resource. And I can open it up to any questions, should there be any. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel, for your delegation and for your very thorough research on this. Certainly a lot of information you've shared with us, and I appreciate that. Any specific questions, Councillor Eady?
Actually, that's pretty thorough. Thank you. I appreciate the There's historical significance in the people that lived in the area as well back in the late 50s and in the early 60s who were constantly lobbying the city of West Caledonia that the community needed a library. And lo and behold, in 1967, they did get it. So, but anyway, I appreciate and thank you for your presentation. I look forward to hear what our property development, heritage, and downtown development committee. Hopefully, they send it to the heritage committee to consider.
Absolutely, and I'll be coming to that committee as well to support. The motion should it pass today. So, thank you.
And as Councillor Eady noted, Daniel, you're aware of the process going to the PP&D committee, and if they agree, then it'll go to the historical resources committee. I know you've followed this sort of conversation before. You've got a great interest in it. And again, thank you so much for this detail. And it's on the public record here. I see our clerk has attached it to the agenda item.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, committee, seeing the time, I think we can take a few minutes to hear from Cindy Tugwell, and then after we have to get into hearings. So welcome, Ms. Tugwell.
Good morning, councillors. I'm very happy to be here. This is a celebratory day, just days away from when the library first opened. June 24th, 1967. So we're only days away from that. I am not going to follow Daniel with any more historical information. He's done an amazing job. So I'm here in a very supportive role today to thank Councillor Eady for his initiation on this and his lead. So thank you very much. And I know Councillor Santos and Councillor Sharma, you are leaders in preserving heritage when there is a need for it. And in this particular case, modernist architecture is really a gem in Winnipeg, and certainly we're in City Hall right now that was designated in 2019, and the St. Patel Library Heritage Winnipeg had their preservation awards there in 2019. So we really are starting to celebrate modernist architecture, but what I'm here to support is the Friends of West Caledonia Library. They have done an amazing job, and to watch the community organically advocate to keep the library open and now nominate it. The support for the nomination is really to give that peace of mind to the community that it will not be demolished in the future. So this is an insurance policy to future generations to understand the immense value that that community and Winnipeggers already understand when it was built, when it was still the city of West Caledonia. So I'm here to say that modernist architecture is very important, but what that library means to the community is overwhelming to me. When I got the pleasure to work with them after it was kept open to talk about the heritage value and how we could protect it, not only from demolition, but also for any other changes that might be made in the future, it was very important for the community. And so I'm here to support the heritage nomination on behalf of the heritage community, but I have to tell you what an honor and a pleasure to work with these individuals, Friends of West Caledonia. I'm not from that community, but I'm really proud to work with them, and I'm really proud that they included Heritage Winnipeg to help support this cause. So thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. Councillor Eady.
Thank you, Ms. Tugwell. I also just wanted to say I want to thank you for your volunteerism and moved protect our heritage and our history. And you are no stranger to this neighborhood because you're a volunteer on the Seven Oaks House Museum Board, where, you know, really that's the neighborhood that where the city really began for residential. And I appreciate your support of the West Caledonia community, of which Seven Oaks House Museum is part.
Thank you very much. And I just on a footnote, it feels so wonderful to be here in a celebratory way, in a positive way, to work with City Hall, to work with the community. That really means a lot to Heritage Winnipeg. So thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. Great to see you today.
Thank you.
Mr. Clerk, seeing the time, that concludes our delegations. We do have others that wish to be added to the list, but seeing the hour, do we do that? We would have to do that before the hearing starts.
Yes, what we can do is we can move a motion now to hear the additional delegates. And then once we have concluded the public hearings, we'll just go back into delegations.
Okay. I'll move that we only have one additional delegate.
There's two.
Two additional? Okay. Yes. I'll move to suspend the rules and allow for two more additional delegations. One, I believe, is on report.
The first one is for report two, plan approval at 920 Jefferson Avenue. So that's Ashley Martin's. And then we also have Mr. Zach Nemchuk. He would like to appear on plan approval 2402 Ferrier Street, and that's report four on the agenda.
Right. Okay. So moved, Madam Chair.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried.
Perfect. So for everybody in the waiting room waiting to appear in delegation on the various report items, I will put you back into the waiting room for the time being. After public hearings have concluded, I will let you back into the meeting, and then we will resume delegations. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. I think the committee wants to take a short recess. How long? 10 minutes?
7 minutes.
Okay. 10 minutes. Thank you. Good morning. I call the public hearing portion of the Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee to order. It's June 21st, 2022. I'm City Councillor Debbie Sharma, and I'll be the chairperson for today's meeting. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that we're on Treaty 1 territory, the home and traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Innu, and Dakota peoples, and in the national homeland of the Red River Métis. Our drinking water comes from the Shoal Lake 40 First Nation in Treaty 3 territory. Also in the chamber is Councillor Vivian Santos, Councillor Ross Eady. We have members of the administration, Mr. Rack Hare, planner, Mr. Greg Jasper, Land Development Branch, and Ms. Kathy Gagnon, Geomatics Branch, and also the support of our City Clerk, Mr. Peter Prinsloo. We have five items on the agenda. Item one, Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. For a more in-depth overview of the public hearing process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing, please consult the public hearing process brochure, which is available on the City Clerk's Department website. Please note that all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the hearings have concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item 1 is an excess animal permit at 43 Power Street under file PA001/2022. I would now like to hand it over to Mr. Leland Gordon to give us an overview of the matter. Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Gordon.
Good morning. So this is an excess animal permit for 6 dogs, which is 2 dogs over the limit. The Animal Services is recommending a permit for 3 years. We've inspected the property. All the dogs are licensed. 2 of the 6 dogs are spayed and neutered. And that's all I really have to add. Are there any questions?
None at this time. Mr. Clerk?
We do have the applicant, Alexander Lima, in the gallery up there. I don't believe he has a formal presentation prepared, but if the committee has any questions, he could come down.
I would have questions. Just one question. Mr. Lean is okay with that?
He's just coming down to the podium now.
Hi.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning, Mr. Lima. Sounds like you've gone through it's quite a rigorous process going for these conditional ability to have X number of animals. I just wanted to ask you one question. You sound like you're a great neighbor and you're taking great care of your dogs. I just wanted to confirm, though, you're not a dog breeder, right?
No, I am not.
Right. You have six wonderful dogs.
Just bought six dogs.
Right on. Well, let's go. That's all I was, all I wanted to ask.
Awesome. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Yeah, you too.
Thank you. Mr. Clark?
Okay, so I don't know if the committee has any additional questions for Mr. Gordon. If not, we don't need to have rebuttal from the applicant, so we can just move on to motions.
I'm about to, Madam Chair, I'm going to move some motions here, just getting to the text.
And I'll just take this time to ask the people in the gallery if there's anybody else who would like to speak to this item, either in support, in opposition, or for information. Seeing none.
Okay. Okay. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary, that's carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Contrary, that's carried.
Yeah. I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Aye. That's carried.
I move that the criteria under Part 3, Subsection 25.2 of the Responsible Pet Ownership Bylaw, Bylaw 92/2013 are satisfied.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this matter, application, I mean, be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Mr. Clerk?
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application is final and may not be appealed.
Thank you. Item 2, plan approval, 920 Jefferson Avenue. Mr. Clerk?
Item 2 is a subdivision and rezoning at North of Ferrier Street, west of CB Rail, Winnipeg Beach Line, Highland Point, Phase 4, under file DASZ 25 of 2022.
That is correct, Mr. Clerk. Thank you. I had originally read out item 2 from the report section, so my apology. Mr. Hare, summary of the...
Of course, councillors. Yes. So this is an application to subdivide and rezone approximately 65 acres of land in Precinct G in order to create lots, block plans, public reserve lands, and public right-of-ways to accommodate Phase 4 of the Highland Point community. So the site is located east of McPhillip Street and west of the CP Rail Winnipeg Beach Line. It's approximately 100 acres overall in total, of which 65 acres are proposed for development under this application. Under the Complete Communities Direction Strategy 2.0, this is in a recent community policy area, and under the Precinct G Secondary Plan, these lands fall within a variety of policy areas, including medium density, low density, and commercial mixed use. Also of note, this site is north of phases 1, 2, and 3 of Highland Point, which were approved under files DASZ 24 of 19 and DASZ 40 of 2021. So, as stated, it's 65 acres of land that's being subdivided and rezoned. The following would be established. A 16-acre site that would be zoned PR3, Parks and Recreation 3 Regional. This is identified as a potential site for a future high school. A 16-acre public reserve site zoned PR2, Parks and Recreation 2 Community. A 7-acre site zoned PR2, Parks and Recreation 2 Community. This 7-acre site is identified as a potential site for a future K-8 school. A 7.44-acre commercial site zoned C2. This commercial site would be right at the entry to Highland Point from McPhillips. 45 single-family lots zoned R1M, 8 single-family lots zoned R1S, and 6.63 acres of multifamily land zoned RMFM, multifamily medium, opening and extending several public right-of-ways, and finally establishment of a 4.24-acre strip of land along the north side of the planned area. Now for context, the north of the subject lands is the city's snow dump facility. Between the applicant's land and the snow dump facility, there's currently an easement that is for drainage for the snow dump. So that 4.24-acre strip is turning that easement into a piece of land and leaving it zoned ag and transferring it over to the city. The residual lands that the developer still owns would remain zoned ag, roughly 34.5 acres. So those two items are the reasons for the related variance, the 4.24 acre strip and the residual lands that would remain zoned ag. That variance is because the agricultural zone requires a minimum size, lot size of 40 acres. These would be less than 40 acres. So that's the reason for the related variance. In terms of collaborative planning, the applicant consulted with urban planning prior to submitting the application. The applicant did modify some of the proposed zoning districts after consultation with our division, and also engaged in discussions with other City Winnipeg stakeholder departments. In terms of our recommendation, we are recommending approval of the application subject to conditions. I'll briefly touch on some of the high-level pertinent conditions of approval that are relating to the zoning agreement that's being recommended. So on the commercial lands, as well as the two sites that are for potential school sites in the future, as well as on the multifamily sites, we're recommending plan approval via the Lord Selkirk West Kelowna Community Committee and the Director of PP&D. We are also recommending a zoning agreement for the multifamily medium lands to limit height and require certain setbacks. The recommendations in terms of that multifamily site is identical to the recommendations in the previous phases. Essentially, it just, you know, requires taller buildings be further away from lower density homes, as well as requires a minimum density requirement of 15 dwelling units per acre. And that's because of the Precinct G secondary plan. It requires 15 units per acre for multifamily sites. And then for the commercial property, that would be zone C2. We are recommending that no residential uses be permitted. That is because that commercial property would be directly south of a snow dump facility. So to ensure that there's no, the snow dump facility.
Oh, the snow dump, right.
Yeah, okay. So the commercial lot that would be created south of the snow dump, commercial zoning C2 allows residential. We're just recommending that no residential be permitted due to its proximity to the snow dump. And as well, we are recommending that the developer install fencing, continuous uniform fencing to the satisfaction of Public Works and the Director of Planning, Property and Development, along the north limit of the area south of that easement strip that I had mentioned earlier. That concludes my introduction.
Thank you, Mr. Hare. Mr. Clerk, ready for delegations?
Yes, I will just, for the committee's benefit, I will note that this is a combined hearing and item 3 will also be heard at the same time, which is variance at north of Ferrier Street, west of CB Rail, Winnipeg Beach Line, under file DAB 133321/2022D. The applicant, Michael Carruthers, is on Zoom here and he is sharing the screen.
Okay. He's in person. Yeah.
Patient on Zoom.
Yeah. Welcome.
Thank you. Appreciate being here. I am old school. I do have paper copies if interested. I know that we have provided it digitally as well. Thank you. Thank you. I'm happy to be here. To introduce phase 4 of Highland Point, the primary purpose of this application, as Rack had mentioned, is to create two school sites and a community park. Okay, you take me to the second slide, Brendan. As you're aware, that goes in the process of developing the community of Highland Point in Precinct G. I think this is our fourth time that we've been in front of the committee between the precinct plan and a few of our other applications. Brendan here is with me from Landmark Planning. He's been the planning consultant on this project since day one. Appreciate your assistance, Brendan. Thank you. Slide 3. And then we'll, okay, yeah. So Highland Point Phase 1, I'll just give a brief summary of where we're at today. Highland Point Phase 1 is well underway. We have had a total of 248 single family, duplex, and townhome lots. Many of the homes are under construction presently. Phase 2, we are in the process of servicing the streets and other civil infrastructure, and we expect to have houses under construction in Phase 2 next year. Phase 3 is planned to be serviced next year and houses in the following year, which would be the same time as when we would service Phase 4. So Phase 4 consists of two school sites, a community scale park, a commercial site at McPhillips, and some residential development. Okay, next slide, we get to Precinct G. So Precinct G, the precinct plan sets out the vision, policies, and objectives of the area. This application is consistent with and implements the vision of the precinct plan. There are three primary land uses in the precinct plan: commercial and mixed use, low density residential, and medium-density residential. The application provides for a variety of housing types, single-family, lane lots, and multifamily within the low and medium-density residential policy areas. The school site, the park, and the commercial site are within the commercial and mixed-use designated area. The application provides for a variety of housing types. It includes an integrated pedestrian network. It also includes a co-location of schools and the community park, creating a very unique community focal location. And in general, this application supports the concept of complete communities. Phase four is the culmination of a number of years of planning and cooperation with the Seven Oaks School Division, the City of Winnipeg, and LADCO. Seven Oaks School Division identified the future need for school sites, including a high school site, during our early consultations for the precinct plan. We've been able to work with them to identify an excellent location near the entrance to Highland Point with great access to McPhillips Street and the broader community. This site is 15 acres in size with a large 16-acre community park to the east and a 7-acre elementary school site on the other side of the park. This will create about a 38-acre focal point for not only this neighborhood, but also for the greater community. The application also includes a commercial site directly adjacent to McPhillips, 53 single-family lots, and 6.86 acres of multifamily. This residential component is being brought on early to provide secondary transportation access to the elementary school site. This was identified as required by Public Works early in our planning stages. We're also formalizing the drainage for the city snow dump, turning the drainage easement into a city-owned property, as RAC has already explained. So the 16-acre community park is located between the two school sites. It is expected to meet the requirements for active park space in Highland Point, and being co-located with schools will provide opportunities for mixed programming and active use. It'll be a great neighborhood and broader community amenity. The park is well connected to the active transportation network, with pathways along both Ferrier and Fernbank Avenue, and is centrally located where these two collector streets intersect. This is essentially in the heart of our community. Multifamily residential is also directly across the street from this park in both phase one and the multifamily sites in phase four. Okay. Continuing in the theme of connectivity, this has been a key factor in the design of Highland Point and Precinct G. There are internal and external active transportation connections leading to the park and the school sites, and sidewalks are located on all streets, including on local streets with sidewalks on one side. We've worked very closely with the city administration on this proposal, and we've addressed a number of recommendations, including collector frontage on two sides of the school sites. Both school sites will have great transportation access on collector streets. Two points of transportation access to the elementary school site. We've coordinated with parks planning. We've identified the parking and snow storage plans, and we've addressed the snow dump drainage. We've reviewed the planner's report and the ACG report, and we have no concerns. Okay, to conclude, I'd like to extend the appreciation to the administration and the Seven Oaks School Division. This is a truly unique opportunity, one that I do not believe LADCO has had the opportunity to be involved with in the past. We look forward to continuing to work on this in the years to come. So this is essentially the first step in a multi-step long-term process. This is the formal planning component where we've established and created the sites. And we've done this well before they're actually needed. The step is often overlooked, but we're happy to be able to have worked early in the process to identify these sites and create them. It'll be a number of years until the schools are contemplated, approved, and built, and there'll be a number of additional opportunities for discussion, collaboration, and planning on the part of the school division, the city, and the province. We also look forward to continuing to work in this process as well, including in the next year or so, we'll start with some planning and design of the park, and we will involve the coordination of LADCO as the landowner, or the developer, sorry, and the school division and the city. So on behalf of LADCO, I would like to thank you for your time, and if there are any questions, we can answer them now, or we can wait till the end. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Brendan, will you be addressing us as well, or just there for support?
Just for support.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Reedy?
I just wanted to applaud Latco that, you know, and I'm not quite sure how everything went over in Waverly West, but I think this is fantastic that in building this part of the city, you're moving forward with already allocating. So when somebody buys a house and you say there's going to be a school there, you know there's going to be a school there, right?
Wow.
So that's why I'm applauding. Yeah. But it's a good thing.
I agree, Councillor Reedy. I think it's good to have these conversations so early on in the process, as Michael mentioned, which is to clarify, it's potentially a school site. It's not 100% confirmed, but do you want to put something on the record?
Yeah, the construction of schools is
that's
approved by the province, and they'll approve the construction of the schools at the time that they're needed. So at this point in time, there isn't the requirement for schools, but the sites themselves are set aside. And that's the first step in the planning. And we have experienced in the past in some other communities where school sites typically not requested by the school division until they're needed, which often is too far in advance or too far down the process and you can't even find the sites. So this is creating the sites for when they are required, they will be there for the school division and the province. We're not allowed to advertise and to identify these sites as school sites until the province has approved a school. So we can talk about them during the planning process, but we as LADCO are not allowed to, or as a developer, not allowed to advertise and market the school sites. So when people do come in and ask what the sites are, our answer will be that they are owned by the school division, but there is no real notification of when a school will be built.
Right.
Okay. That's right. There is some provincial legislation that restricts what and regulates what developers can say about school sites.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But Michael, I really appreciate your collaboration with all the stakeholders as usual, you know, with the city administration. We also had a chance to meet a while back, and my feedback was incorporated through your discussions with the planner. So I appreciate you taking care of all the items as you listed. And we'll have conversations going forward on the park and how it's going to take shape. I know you'll be discussing that with the school division. I'd like to be involved, as I mentioned to you earlier, in that process as well. This will be a large park site, and it'll be serving the school community, but also the community at large.
Yes.
We need to balance both of those interests. Mm-hmm. Need to be balanced, yeah. Yeah.
Can I just...
Councillor Reedy, yeah.
Just a follow-up question, though. The sizable 16-acre park, is it the vision that would proceed at the point that you built out the neighborhood there?
Yeah, we will be working on planning on that park in the next 2 years. There is another park that we'll be developing before this one.
Oh, okay.
So we'll plan it over the next couple of years, and it'll likely be developed in stages. It is 16 acres. It's very large. I would envision working on developing portions of it right up front, so within the next 3 to 4 years. And then there likely will be portions of it that will be developed as time goes. Mm-hmm. And we will be required to have it fully developed before Highland Point is finished development. So it will be probably a 10-year process, mm-hmm. but it will be built out on stages.
Yes. Cool. So, Michael, no further questions. Just wanted to personally thank you for being here. We don't always see the applicant here, the developer, and you've always come to be on the public record alongside, of course, your consultant. So thank you for that. It means a lot.
Yep, happy to be here.
Mr. Clerk, next.
So those in support of this application, I have Brendan Salico, who expressed that he's not going to be presenting. I also had Tyler Smith registered, but I believe he's no longer available. Then I also had Jennifer Maitrey from the school division, but I don't see her here. Garrett Ireland, who's also in support. Garrett, would like to come and speak. And Maggie DeGaine, also here in support, seeing no speakers there. I had nobody in opposition, nobody for information. Is there anybody else here in the gallery today who would like to speak to this item? Okay. Seeing none, Madam Chairperson.
Okay, thank you. Any questions for the public service? Okay, is there anything you'd like to add, Mr. Hare, on the record at this time?
No, Councillor.
No, we're good.
Anything okay. further, Mr. Crothers? No?
Mr. Crothers, any last word?
No last word, just thank you. And the way that we try to develop our land is to make sure that there is nobody in opposition.
Right. Yeah. Well, we appreciate your collaboration, and that shows. And please continue to reach out to all the stakeholders, including my office. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, do you want me to take the chair?
Okay.
So you want to move?
Yes.
Okay, I'll take the chair.
Thank you, Councillor Santos is in the chair. I'll move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service, Madam Chair, be taken as read.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And that's carried unanimously.
I'll move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? And that's carried unanimously.
I'll move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Standing Policy Committee. Or, pardon me, it'll go to the Executive Policy Committee, Mr. Clerk? Yeah, to the EPC Committee via the priority rezoning process.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
And anybody opposed? And that's carried unanimously.
I do have some comments I'd like to put on the record. This development, Madam Chair, represents the fourth phase of the Highland Point community. In the previous three phases, as we heard, we approved development covering 165 acres of land. And this includes approving more than 500 new lots for residential development that we know is needed. North Winnipeg's growing. It's a place that people want to live and raise their family. And we also approved many acres of multifamily land, neighborhood parkland, and commercial land. This fourth and latest phase will add additional amenities and services that are necessary to support this growing future neighborhood. The location of the proposed park would tie into the walking and cycling network that is being planned. The new commercial areas, as well as the potential school sites, will offer additional amenities and support the development of Highland Point as a complete community. And as we heard, this is all consistent with the Precinct 2 secondary plan. LADCO has a dedicated and strong track record of collaboration with stakeholders, and I applaud them for that. We hope they continue this collaboration. I know they will as they plan their future development phases. And thank you for your support. I know you've been very interested in this file and often ask me questions offline. So really excited that we're moving forward with this.
Okay. Any other speakers?
Councillor Petey? No. Ditto to Councillor Sherman.
Okay, all those, I'll call the question. All those in favor for the supporting Aye. Reasons that Councillor Sharma have made?
Aye.
Okay, nobody's opposed, and that's carried unanimously.
I'll move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And that's carried unanimously. Okay, will you be moving?
Now on the variance?
Okay.
Yeah. I'll move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And that's carried unanimously.
I'll move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
And that's carried unanimously.
I'll move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. And Madam Chair, it is the minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and it is compatible with the area in which the property affected is situated. And I did already put my supporting comments on the record in the previous item too.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that's carried unanimously.
I'll move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and that the variance be approved.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that's carried unanimously.
I'll move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that's carried unanimously.
So regarding the DASZ, please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted on the subdivision and rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council. And respecting the variance, please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. Before we move on, I also want to thank Mr. Herr, our planner, for his dedication and efforts, his attention to detail, above all, on this file. Thank you. Next item, item five.
Item four.
Four.
So item four is a variance at 2091 Brookside Boulevard under file DAV 122137/2022D. And I will note for the committee that the recommendation from the public service is to adjourn this hearing to the September 1st meeting of the Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee due to improper posting.
Councillor Eadie moves adjournment.
Yes, Madam Chair, I'll move adjournment until the September 4th Lord Selkirk West.
Is it September 1st or 4th?
First. Yes.
Okay, thank you. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary, that's carried.
All right. Then,
next.
Lastly, let me just admit the applicant there. Okay, so our last hearing item for today is item number five, and it is a demolition at 445 Monraith Street under file DEMO 132149/2022D. Please note that additional communications were received in support of this matter after the agenda was published, which has been distributed to all members of the committee. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. At this time, I would like to pass it over to our planner to give us an overview of the matter. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. So this is an application, councillors, to demolish a single-family dwelling without a building permit to construct a new structure. So the property is located on the east side of Monreith Street in the Robertson neighborhood of the Minarski Ward. It's a 50-foot wide lot. It's zoned single family, and there's currently a single family dwelling with a detached garage on the property. In addition to the demolition variance application, the applicant has also applied for a subdivision to subdivide this property into two 25-foot wide lots, as well as variances to establish each lot as a buildable lot and construct two single family dwellings. The intent behind the demolition is to remove the existing structure and prepare the site for construction as they work through the process of registering the subdivision and providing drawings for the permit. So although they are requesting this variance to demolish without a permit, we do anticipate permits should be applied for relatively soon. If not, we are recommending a condition of approval that within 12 months the lot be sodded and to the satisfaction of the director of PP&D. The variance application, as well as the variance application, I should note, is a C-type application, which previously would have gone to the Board of Adjustment. Now these are approved by the Director of PP&D. The variances for lot area and lot width have been approved and are currently posted on the property. My understanding is the appeal deadline is on the 28th. The public notice for this demo was also posted on the property. I'll note for the committee's records that we did receive one phone call from a neighbor about the applications. They were just more so curious as to what was happening. They indicated that the grass hadn't been cut in a while, so I provided them information to the report so they can get in contact with the owner and the applicant directly. They did not indicate any concern with the proposed development. So with that, that concludes my introduction, and we are recommending approval of the demo variance.
So just to confirm, Mr. Herr, so really what we have here in lieu of a permit is actually an application for subdivision. Has that actually been put into the queue?
The application for subdivision is in the queue. I believe the approval letter has been sent to the applicant. That's an administrative approval for the subdivision. The variance, which is associated with the subdivision, has also been approved for the lot area lot width variances. It has been posted on the property. The demolition variance is kind of a parallel but separate matter in some ways.
Yeah.
It is for demolition of the building without those permits to build new. So they're somewhat connected in that we know what the future plans for this property are, but they're also separate processes because it's...
That's right. I just wanted to clarify a little bit.
That it's a little confusing.
There's a definite knowledge of what's going to be done with this property, right? It's not like there's no permit, there's no application, and there's nothing. This is there's something in the works for this property.
Okay. That is correct, yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. The applicant?
Yes, we have the applicant, Mr. Christopher Gibson, on the line. Mr. Gibson, if you can go ahead and unmute your mic, you'll have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation starting now. Thank you.
Hopefully everyone can see me and my screen. Good morning, councillors and the public administration. Thank you for allowing me to speak to this application today. My name is Chris Gibson. I'm a planner for Richard Winter Planning and Development. Our firm has been retained by the proponents to assist in the planning and development application process for 445 Monreef. I'm here today to speak upon seeking the approval for the demo variance for the removal of the house and the garage at the site ahead of the building permits, so our application can prepare the site for construction. A development application has been submitted, as mentioned, and as we also require plan approval for our development prior to application applying for these building permits. The details of the application before you today was well described earlier by the city planner, so I'll keep this brief. Just to do a quick subject lines overview, as mentioned, the property is located on the southeast side of Monreef between Church and Mountain Avenue. It is a 55-foot wide lot in the infill guideline area 1 and is zoned residential single family medium. On the site is a one-story 600 square foot home built in 1947 and a detached garage. The images shown on the screen display the home and the garage in a state of disrepair with roof and water damage, as well as showing a large piece of board that is currently leaning against the rear of the house, covering up a large hole on the exterior wall. The property was purchased in this condition, this current state, and with the intention for redevelopment. I've also included some images of the homes in the adjacent to 445 Monreef. The homes in the neighborhood are well kept, and the majority of these homes are being in decent and decent condition and repair. This house at this location is currently vacant. Properties that sit vacant for long periods of time are at risk for trespassing, vandalism, and unsafe uses and activities. Having houses sit vacant produces unappealing aspects for the neighborhood, as well as can pose health and public safety concerns. These vacant structures have a negative spillover effect and can become liabilities to neighboring properties. Arson or accidental fires are a particular problem for vacant structures. In recent years, there have been many news headlines depicting issues of vacant dwellings. Like a headline here in 2020 reads, "Hundreds of vacant buildings scattered across Winnipeg pose fire risk," says the fire chief. Please. Another article from last month.
Councillor Santos and I don't need to be reminded. Don't worry about that, okay?
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm just going through my slides. Sorry.
You're talking to people who have lived experience trying to help people deal with this stuff. So anyway, thank
you. For sure. And again, just some of the articles here, just even last week, Bacon House sent 3 firefighters to the hospital and displaced 16 neighbors. In addition, like, we wanted to make sure that these houses do not pose a negative effect on the neighborhood as they sit vacant as we wait for these applications to go through. So just for our next steps, we understand the typical process of obtaining a demo permit is using conjunction with the building permits. We are requesting the approval of the demo application. It is not to just tear it down these structures and leave the land vacant. There's currently a proposed development plan for the site to subdivide into the 225-foot wide lots. Our client would like to get to building this year and has no intentions of delaying the construction once the building permits are issued. and approving the demo variance will merely help streamline this process and allowing our clients to prepare the site for construction while we work with the city towards the building permits. This will ensure that the structures also will not become liabilities to the neighborhood while sitting vacant during this time. And I'd like to thank you again for letting me speak today on this application and to seeking approval for the demolition variance ahead of the building permits. And I can answer any questions you may have.
Councilor Reedy, first question.
Yes. The only question I have is related to the lived experience of the Minarski Ward office when it comes to vacant properties and properties that are about to be under construction and under construction. My question is, will the owner of the property and those proceeding with the new development pay special attention to make sure that there are no neighborhood livability violations happening in terms of keeping grass, keeping the construction site and everything clear without affecting the neighboring properties?
That's a really good question. The landowner has been notified of the grass maintenance. I made sure that they were aware of this. I actually spoke to one of the neighbors as well who resides across the street this morning, who also informed me of the grass condition. This was an oversight on their part to have this continuously maintained, and this will be done going forward. They were anticipating to do this today, but with the complete downpour, I'm hoping that this will be done as soon as the grass will be dry enough to cut. And of course, the safety is always a concern for the neighborhood, and they'll be ensure that things will be set in place to make sure that these sites are well maintained going forward.
Okay, and you can let the owner know the city council for the area is going to hold them up to that, right?
Yes. Right.
That's it, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Next presenter, Mr. Clerk.
I don't have any additional persons registered.
So no one in support? No one in opposition? No one for information?
Nope, and nobody in the gallery either. Okay.
Any questions for the Public Service Committee? No questions. Let's move on. Mr. Gibson has an opportunity to speak in rebuttal. If you choose to add anything, no new information, of course.
No, I am good. Thank you for, other than saying thank you for hearing me today.
Thank you for that.
Great.
Time for motions.
I'm ready to move, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Go ahead.
I move. There is nobody else, right, Mr. Clerk?
No.
Move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary,
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken. The recommendation?
Be concurred in?
Should be concurred in.
All in favor?
Aye.
I move that the criteria under Part 9, Section 46.3 of Development Procedures Bylaw, number 104/2020, are satisfied.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried.
I move, before I move that this is concluded, I just want to make a comment, Madam Chair, that I appreciate the work being done with this property, and unlike some other places in my ward, this is proceeding, and it is a really excellent neighborhood there, and you're not far away from a lot of different amenities, and so it's a great place to subdivide a lot and build a couple more houses. I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Mr. Clerk?
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Thank you. We'll now go back to the report section. Delegations, Mr. Clerk?
Yes. Did the committee want to take another brief recess? Or
I think we want to keep going.
I just got to take a quick...
5 minute?
Yeah.
Okay. 5 minute recess is in order. Thank you. Good morning. I'd like to reconvene our Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee meeting, a regular agenda. It's June 21st, 2022. And I'm Councillor Debbie Sharma, chairperson of this committee, Councillor Vivian Santos, and Councillor Rossidi, and members of the administration. We're going to continue on with delegations, Mr. Clerk. Next one is Mr. Jeff Pratt, if you could call him forward.
Yes, our next delegation is Jeff Pratt. To be heard with respect to Report 7, and that is Proposed Servicing Agreement, DASSF519/2020, Proposed Subdivision of Land Located at 2091 Brookside Boulevard. So Jeff, if you want to start your video, unmute your mic, and I will also note for the committee that Jeff has submitted a submission after the deadline, so we'll just need to suspend the rules to allow him to present that.
I move to suspend the rules to allow him to submission.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Welcome, Jeff.
Hello. Thank you, and thank you for allowing me to share this presentation. I encountered some internet difficulties yesterday. I'm out of the city and was unable to get it to the clerk, so I appreciate that. Thank you. And I will also thank you for allowing me to be here today, and I will just clarify the posting issue for the variance that was on the agenda earlier. There's a bit of a miscommunication with the landowner who's located out of the province, and it just didn't make it up in time. So I apologize for that as well, and we'll see you in September to discuss those variances. Thank you very much. I'm here to talk about a pretty unique situation that this land is encountering. And I'll provide a little bit of a background and a bit of an overview, and ultimately propose a couple potential solutions why we're here to discuss the servicing agreement for a proposed subdivision at 2091 Brookside Boulevard in Winnipeg. So I'm Jeff Pratt with Landmark Planning and Design here in Winnipeg, and we've been working with an out-of-province trucking company, CAT Incorporated. They're based out of Quebec, and they purchased 2091 Brookside, which is an existing cross-dock trucking facility, and there is a sort of underutilized piece of land immediately to the south of that existing cross dock that's on the same piece of land, the same lot, but currently is sort of underutilized and is just some, you know, is basically vacant. So they're trying to subdivide it to establish a trailer, like a transportation trailer sales and servicing site. So here you see the subject site. Highlighted on this is the existing cross dock. But immediately to the south of that, on this aerial photograph where you see that sort of pile of gravel and driveway, that is all part of the same property. So we're here to discuss the entire area, also back to that sort of gravel laneway you see at the rear of the site. It's about 19-acre site in total, north of Inksbrook, south of Jefferson, along that long stretch of Brookside where there's many trucking companies located and various sort of industrial uses. The site does already have existing industrial zoning. Really what's being talked about here does conform to all of the city's planning documentation, such as our Winnipeg and complete communities. This site is located within the employment lands designation. It is intended for light and medium industrial development, and all those sorts of great things. The piece in question is that our Winnipeg Complete Communities states that development should have a full range of municipal services. And this site does not currently have that. However, I would suggest that we can, you know, more or less provide that. And this is a unique situation. I've had a lot of discussions with the City of Winnipeg administration, both from planning, public works, water and waste. And there's, you know, I don't, obviously the City of Winnipeg administration has to interpret the policies and they look to do that consistently. But, you know, there is, I would say from my discussions, a general understanding that the site we're talking about today does present a bit of a unique situation. So here's a more detailed drawing of what would be proposed here. I'm going to advance to the next slide. It shows a little better. So what we have shown in green, it's sort of an L-shaped parcel, would be proposed lot 2, and that encompasses the existing 45,000 square foot cross-dock facility, and CAT would like to put more parking for trucks and trailers in the back of that site. Proposed lot 1, which is shown sort of highlighted in red, would be the proposed new use, which would include about a 20,000 square foot building used for selling large transport trailers and providing some services for those as well. So really fits in with the characteristics of what's currently along this stretch of Brookside. And we're really talking about a subdivision to create this new proposed lot 1 to incorporate a new use on it. So the servicing is really the question. So there's not currently a range of full municipal services at the site for most of the properties adjoining the site as well. They're kind of grandfathered in. We can extend a wastewater sewer from just south of the property. So wastewater will be taken care of. Water and waste is okay with draining the site into the existing drainage ditches along Brookside Boulevard. So you know, land drainage is okay. It's on a paved road, which is another component of a full range of municipal services. So, you know, three of the four big ones are taken care of. Where it gets a little more interesting is the water provision. Currently, the site and most of the sites in this area are have private wells on site. And there is already a well on site serving the cross-dock facility. The City of Winnipeg administration's default is to say that in order for this subdivision to occur and a new use to be established, that they would have to extend a new water main to serve the site. The complicated issue being that there's currently water nearby to the site to the south, but the city requires it to be looped. They can't just extend it at that end. So in order to provide looped water to the site, would require basically a 2.5 kilometer water main extension that, you know, as things stand now, would be the requirement of this development proponent to front end, to put in themselves and hope to maybe get some payments back in the future if other landowners do decide to tap into it, which, you know, ultimately does not allow for this site to have new development occur on it. So, you know, generally speaking, we would say that, yeah, we agree that the site should have a full range of municipal services. But the interesting thing is that the Complete Communities Direction Strategy does have some wording that speaks to, and this is in 1.2, that the city can consider sustainable alternatives to a full range of municipal services where the following conditions are satisfied: that the applicant can demonstrate that the alternative provides a comparable level of service and safety in an environmentally sound and economical manner, and the alternative has been accepted as satisfactory by the directors of public works, water, waste, and PP&D. So really what I'm asking for is to just bump the you know, to speak to this policy and say, at the end of the day, it's going to be up to the development proponent to demonstrate via the permitting process that they can provide sufficient fire flows, that they can meet all the building code standards. But given that it's not, you know, really feasible for them to undertake a 2.5 kilometer water main extension, you know, I would suggest that this policy does open up the window for them to demonstrate that they can serve their site in a sustainable manner using the existing well on site and, or, you know, if necessary, drilling a new well and using cisterns for fire flow. So that's really what we're talking about. We're not talking about a free ride or anything like that. So really what is in the administrative report right now is Schedule B under Section 2, Servicing Conditions, number 1, Water Mains. Currently the wording in the report is the developer shall, at no expense to the city, construct and install all water mains required to serve the planned area, as indicated in the servicing report, to the satisfaction of the Director of Water and Waste. So in some discussions I had with the administration, in terms of how this might occur, you know, we were proposing a temporary solution to be considered, once again, having to meet all building code requirements. There are also, you know, the landowner could upfront their share of any servicing costs for the water main extension. And that, you know, we really look at it as part of the permitting process for them to demonstrate that they can do this sustainably. So in terms of proposed solutions to this issue, it seems like the most straightforward might be to just change number 1, water mains, to the developer shall pay their frontage share of the future water main connection on demand. So they pay the city their share of that water main extension, and then when that happens at some point in the future, you know, they have to tap into it, and they've paid their share of it. Another option might be, in the servicing report, to change from water mains to servicing report, as part of the permit approval, provide a servicing report prepared by a qualified municipal engineer to demonstrate the capacity of on-site private water services to provide adequate fire flows to meet building code requirements. So to just state that, you know, they have to demonstrate that to the administration, and that could also be accompanied by the front ending of their share. So I'm just about done here. If you could grant me one more minute, perhaps.
So moved. I think one minute. 1 minute.
Okay. Councillor Santos moves 1 minute extension. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried.
Thanks. So I just want to be really clear that requiring a full range of municipal services is a sound policy to have, and we're not suggesting that it isn't. But our Winnipeg Complete Communities are a one-size-fits-all document, and there are sometimes unique situations that maybe need to be looked at a little outside of this. The proposed development will make better use of underutilized land. It aligns with the Employment Lands Directives and the policies of our Winnipeg and Complete Communities. It offers an opportunity for the city to be competitive with industrial lands outside of the city. And, you know, like the PR dedication requirement alone is in six figures that would be paid to the city here. And, you know, frankly, no one is saying that they don't want water on this site, but it's not really feasible to have one property owner extend by 2.5 kilometers. And once again, Section 1.2 of the Communities Direction Strategy, I do believe, makes provision for this. So with that, I do thank you very much.
Thank you. With that, we'll take any questions. Councillor Eady?
I'm sorry, what is the commercial activity happening on this property?
So there is an existing building for cross-dock trucking, so where you know, the tractor trailers back up to this facility and goods can be moved between them. So that already exists. And what they're proposing is to create a second lot on a vacant part of the site to allow for the sale of like large, you know, 53-foot trailers.
Oh, they're selling. Okay. So there's no water main. Where do firefighters get their water? Is there fire hydrants?
So there are there's an existing water main to the south of this site. Water and Waste doesn't want it extended as a dead end extension. So once again, you know, this is a unique situation, go ahead, Councillor.
But like I heard you refer to fire safety on the lot and that kind of stuff. So from, I don't know how far south that is, but there's fire hydrant there for firefighters to draw water, or do they have to show up there with tankers if there's a fire?
So my understanding is that, you know, as part of the permit process, if you do not have an full municipal water, you would have to have on-site cisterns, et cetera, that would meet building code requirements for fire protection. And so that's a little outside of my area of expertise. I can't say definitively what all that is. However, what we are asking is for the opportunity for the landowner to demonstrate to planning, property, and development via the permitting process that they can achieve that.
Okay. And other question was, when you're referring to complete communities, I think I heard you say complete communities 2.0, which is now the in place bylaw. Is that right?
Correct. My understanding is it is now fully in place. When we started this process, it was still in that interim stage where it was sort of being referred to as the future policy, but wasn't technically fully adopted yet.
It is now, right? Okay. Actually, are you familiar with the secondary plan the council passed for the airport west, Centerport South industrial area, in where I believe in that secondary plan they indicated a whole section of land in there that may not require full city servicing for, yeah, but it's for only certain kinds of commercial activity. Are you
correct,
familiar with what that commercial activity is, where they don't have to have the full service?
That one was, it did speak to low intensity uses that would not require much water. Off the top of my head, whether this would fit within that, I couldn't say for sure. I think it might, but without referencing the document specifically, I couldn't say for sure. But yeah, what you bring up is interesting, because there are parts of the city where there's secondary plans in place that allow for development to occur without a full range of municipal services. And that includes some rural residential areas where homes are on septic and wells, and also some commercial and industrial areas. And one of the things where, you know, Winnipeg arguably has a hard time competing with some of its neighbors is that you can cross the municipal boundary into some of the RMs and undertake these types of development without the full range of municipal services. So this is, it's a unique situation where I think in the future there might be that water main extended. It's arguably kind of onerous to ask this landowner to extend a 2.5 kilometer water main in and of themselves to front end that. So the question is really, I guess, you know, if we say that, well, we just want the full range of municipal services, and we're not willing to explore whether the water can be provided via a well, then, you know, that's a decision made just saying that, well, these lands are going to basically remain in an underutilized state until water is extended. But I would suggest that 1.2 of the complete communities direction strategy, you know, the way I read that, the applicant can demonstrate that the alternatives provide a comparable level of service. I would suggest that would say in a situation like this, allow them the opportunity to demonstrate that. Or in some of the discussions I've had with the public service, it was sort of indicated that perhaps requiring that on-demand payment of the water main extension would technically achieve, the idea that they've contributed to a full range of municipal services, even though they're not in place yet, and they would have to have a temporary solution.
I'm sorry. So that option is, your property owner pays in their share into a fund that eventually builds out the 2.5 kilometer water main. Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah, basically, the city of Winnipeg would take their frontage along Brookside, they have a set sort of water main frontage fee as part of their local improvements that I think is $97 a linear foot, and say, okay, for your subdivision to be approved, you have to give us that money now, just like they have to pay their PR dedication, which I believe is $133,000. So, you know, like this development going forward does contribute a lot to the city of Winnipeg's coffers and you know, competitiveness, not to mention creating jobs and making better use of a site that's really just a patch of dirt and gravel right now. And I think I want to be really clear too that when we're talking about the full range of municipal services, I would never come before the committee and propose doing like a new industrial park, you know, a large development, and say, oh, well, we don't need the full range of municipal services, even though our Winnipeg says we do. This is a unique situation where we're really just infilling on an existing industrial lot.
Thank you. No further questions. Jeff, just quickly, who have you been coordinating with at the city? Have you had conversations with Daniel Trenchard, Greg Jasper?
I had many conversations with Daniel Trenchard, Kevin Cowlick at Water and Waste, as well as Brack, the district planner as well. So we've had some discussions, and I fully recognize too that the administration needs to lean back on their policies and how they interpret it. But I would suggest that this site, this situation is a little unique, and the way I read Complete Communities does allow for consideration of this.
Okay. Thank you. Seeing no further questions, we appreciate your presentation today.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Clerk, next.
Next, we have Harp Brar to be heard with respect to plan approval at 920 Jefferson Avenue, which is Report 2, file DAZ322/79. If I could just ask you to unmute your microphone, and you'll have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation starting now. Thank you.
Thank you, Kurt. Thank you, everyone, for giving the time to be here today. Just to introduce myself, my name is Harp Brar. I'm the development lead for Western Canada for Crombie REIT. So, we are the landlords of the asset at 920 Jefferson Avenue. I'm going to be fairly short today. Our lawyer as well as architect is available to speak as well. I just really wanted to come here today and express our excitement to potentially be able to add a Starbucks pad to our location. We feel like it's a really obviously it's a great strong retail offering that we think will complement the center well. We started investing money into the asset in 2019, starting with a conversion to Freshco, and we feel like this new potential offering could really help sort of round out the site. The area in question is currently today a parking lot. We feel like the design of the Starbucks is really strong and will front on to McPhillips really well. And we've also added a lot of landscaping around the drive-through. And so just want to come here today and express our support and hopefully we have yours to move forward with our application, which does have planning support.
Thank you, Mr. Barr, for your presentation. Seeing no questions, we'll move on to the next delegation. Thank you for your time today.
The next delegation is John Martins to be heard on the same matter.
Good morning, Mr. Martins. I think you might—
Yes, good morning. Or perhaps good afternoon by now. Thank you very much for allowing me to appear again. I was before the committee on May 2nd, 2022, when the matter was put over to today's date. You have my submission dated April 28, 2022, and I know the councillors had several questions which we addressed the last time around, so I'm really here to reiterate what Mr. Harper mentioned, that the client here, Snowcat, Crombie REIT, are excited to proceed with the matter as it relates to the court matter. The appeal remains pending as it relates to the prescriptive easement claim that I know the councillors are aware of. But as outlined in our last submission, in our respectful view, that should not stop the committee from proceeding with the plan approval that's before you today, based on the plans that have been submitted and all of the information that's before you, including based on the development procedure bylaw that allows you to consider plan approval. So happy to answer any questions from the councillors. We're hoping the matter does proceed today.
Thank you, Mr. Martins, and thanks for the submission. I see it attached to the item.
Thank you.
Yeah. No questions at this time. Mr. Clerk, the next delegation.
Next delegation is Braden Cornick to be heard on the same matter. Braden, if you want to start your video, unmute your mic, and you'll have up to 10 minutes to make a presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Clerk and council members. I won't repeat what my colleague, Mr. Martin, said today. I was here on a in case there's a scheduling issue for him, but his submissions are my submissions, and so I'll yield my time. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Clerk, next delegation.
Next delegation, we have Peter Helimandaris to be heard on the same matter. If you can turn on your video and unmute your mic, you'll have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation starting now. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Peter Helimandaris. I appeared before you last time. I'm the lawyer for Niata, the owner of the land which Thunderbird Restaurant sits on. Last time I had discussed two issues. One was the litigation. The other was our conversations with former Councillor Michael Shaughnessy, who had had some involvement in the development of the Thunderbird Restaurant, along with its expansion in 1985. Firstly, with respect to the litigation, we filed our written argument yesterday. The Snowcat property owners now have 30 days to file their written argument, at which point the court will set a date, hopefully, for the appeal to be heard in the fall. Now, with respect to our discussions with Councillor O'Shaughnessy, he indicated to us that there should be a lot of documentation concerning the development, which, you know, we've done our searches and we couldn't find, but we've gone back searching for more documentation to understand exactly how the development proceeded. And I can just give you some highlights of some of the things that we did discover. One was with respect to the sewer line. We had always believed that the Thunderbird was not hooked up to the RM of Old Kildonan sewer in 1961, and that's been confirmed. The gray water system, the septic field, was in fact on the land, which is now the Snowcat property, which indicates not only was there an agreement to use the parking next door, it was also the gray water system. Also, we discovered that the owner of the Niata property had asked for a curb cut so that people would be able to enter its parking lot turning left off of Jefferson. It seems to indicate that there was a traffic study that was provided, although we haven't been able to locate that, but that was denied because of safety issues. So there has already been safety issues with respect to this site. Our client has commissioned a traffic study, which we had hoped that we would be able to present to you today, but it's not ready. But the findings are, again, consistent with what we've been saying all along. We understand that the findings will be that there is a at least 14 parking spot deficiency with respect to the Thunderbird restaurant, which is significant and which is going to create circulation of cars looking to park if they want to frequent the Thunderbird. Finally, there was an expansion of the Thunderbird in 1985. And while the Thunderbird might have been grandfathered when the expansion was done in 1985, that would have necessitated it complying with parking to do the expansion. And again, that at that time, 20 parking stalls were required, which were not on the Thunderbird property. So it would have necessitated the city understanding that the Thunderbird had to the right to use the parking next door on the Snowcat property. Otherwise, the expansion, it couldn't have been approved. So we are continuing our search of these records, which as we uncover more, they support the manner in which this development proceeded, which is that the Thunderbird had the right to use the parking next door. And in fact, it can't continue on if it doesn't have that right. So in our view, given the pending appeal and our search for records, we don't think it's should proceed today and the matter should be put over. So that's my, those are my comments. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
I have a question. When do you anticipate this traffic study being ready?
Within a matter of weeks. Okay. 2 weeks, I've been told.
Okay. Thank you. Any further questions? Seeing none, thank you for your presentation today. Mr. Clark, next delegation.
Next delegation on the same item is Ashley Martins. Ashley, if you'd like to go ahead, start your video, unmute your microphone. You'll have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Council, for letting me speak today in regards to the plan approval for 920 Jefferson. I will keep this brief as you are well aware of the design and the scope of work that we are proposing. I'm briefly going to share my screen. Just to highlight a few of the items. So as you are well aware, the site is along McPhillips Street and at Jefferson. And I will just zoom into the key plan. So that is the new development with the CRU to the south, a drive-through to the north. We are reusing all the existing approaches onto the site and just developing within the parking area. So with the site, we are providing the connectivity for pedestrians, along with a beautiful patio to the south for those pedestrians to enjoy, as well as providing an abundance of landscaping to really beautify the site. Where there is currently a parking lot, we would now provide this wonderful green space and plenty of landscaping to really showcase this property. So I would just like to say thank you very much for taking the time to review these documents. And I am free for any questions that you may have regarding the design or the drawing.
Thank you, Ashley. Seeing, I don't see any questions right now. We'll move on to the next delegation.
Our next delegation is Zach Nemchuk from Affinity Architecture, and he is to be heard in support of plan approval 2402 Ferrier Street, which is report 4 on our agenda today. Zach, if you want to start your video, unmute your mic. You'll have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you and good afternoon. My name is Zach Nimchik from Affinity Architecture. And as mentioned, I'm here to speak to the plan approval for 2402 Ferrier as a condition of the rezoning and variance. I'm going to share my screen now. So the site at 2402 Ferrier was rezoned to residential multifamily small, to permit a three-story multifamily development. It contains 27 apartment units with 45 outdoor parking spaces, which provides a parking ratio of 1 to 1.66 for the building. And it contains a mix of 1 and 2 bedroom apartment units. The context of the site is located mid-block on Ferrier Street between Templeton and Beecher Avenue, and it is within less than 1 block walking distance to transit on Templeton. As part of the rezoning, and two variances were sought. The first one was to permit a front yard of 15 feet instead of 20 feet. This was due to the west of the site having 17 and a half feet right-of-way given to be set aside for a future McGregor extension. This caused the building to need to be shifted slightly, and which is why the 5-foot variance was sought. However, the principal building itself is still set back at 20 feet. There is just the balconies and a small build out at the entrance that projects the 5 feet to the, towards the 15-foot setback. The second variance that was requested and granted was for a building height of 36.9 feet instead of 35 feet. This was less than a 5% variance, and this was just due to being able to accommodate the pitch of the roof. The landscape plan, you can see that there is an abundant green space and plantings around the building and within the parking area, as well as 6-foot privacy fences along the north and south property lines. The elevations of the building itself has a traditional look with pitch roof and overhangs meant to keep with the aesthetic of the neighborhood and surrounding buildings. And it features a stone veneer on the lower level with cement board siding at the second and third floors. If there are any questions regarding the plan approval, I'm happy to speak to them.
Thank you. Zach, at the public hearing, a neighbor from Beecher was in attendance and had questions about some trees along the north property line. How did you resolve this matter?
Those trees are to be removed. They would have needed to been removed anyways to accommodate the parking along that stretch of the property line.
Okay. Are you you're planting other trees though in the area?
Of course. Yes. Yeah.
And what kind of market demographics are you targeting for this complex? Seniors, student housing, what is it? Is it condos, apartments? What are you doing here?
It is apartments. I'm actually not totally aware of what the target demographic is. But it is apartment rentals.
Okay. And what is your timeline for construction?
The builder was hoping to get into the ground this summer. Pending the plan approval, we would go through the permitting process and get in as soon as possible.
Okay. Thank you. I don't see any further questions. Thank you for your presentation today.
Thank you.
Mr. Clerk?
Those are all the delegations I have.
That concludes our delegations. Let's get into the reports. Yep. Item one, occasional liquor permit, Pollux Hardware Co-op Street Festival. Councillor Eady?
I'll move to ratify our decision. I think we already decided to go ahead.
We did. Thank you.
Ratify our decision to allow this community event.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Item two, plan approval, 920 Jefferson Avenue. Just wondering if our planner has anything new to add at this point?
Nothing, Councillor.
Okay. Nothing new.
I just had a quick question for the clerk. This is the 920. How many times have we?
We made it over for 60 days, right? That was the what's before us today?
Yes. So the first time this appeared on our agenda was on May 2nd. Right. So that was technically three meetings ago. The procedure by the development procedures bylaw states we can lay it over up to the third regular scheduled meeting, which is the case here, so we cannot lay this over another time.
Great. Good.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Clerk, for that. Again, we continue to see some legal issues that are brought forward. We don't have the ability at this meeting to go in camera with our legal department. I'm not comfortable making a decision today. We do need to have it proceed, Mr. Clerk. So again, not comfortable making a decision at this committee today. Legal should be spoken to. We can do that at other committees. And as a result, Mr. Clerk?
Yes, according to section 15 brackets 3 of the development procedures bylaw 104 of 2020, it reads, where a community committee fails to make a decision or provide recommendations as required by subsection 1, the city clerk must refer the matter to SDC. So we will have to refer this to the Standing Policy Committee on Property Development Heritage and Downtown Development.
And do we need a vote on that or no? And I'd like to proceed that way.
So I'll move to refer. That is
It'll just go up automatically, yeah. As I stated in my preamble there. We're still legal matters. We don't have the ability to go in camera with our legal department. We've been down this road before. So as a result, Mr. Clerk, you write into the record, the next step will be, if you can just reiterate that.
Yes, it will have to go up to the Standing Policy Committee for their consideration, as this committee is unable to make a decision today.
And that meeting is next month, I believe?
Yes, the next meeting of the SBC is on July the 4th, so that would likely have to be an addendum onto that agenda.
Or it could be the September meeting. You'll check that procedurally.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Next, moving on, item 3, plan approval. Northeast corner of McPhillip Street and North Point Boulevard. Yeah, Mr. Hare, if you can give us a summary.
I'd be happy to.
We heard from the delegation this morning.
Yes, the delegation did cover most of it. So this is a property at the northeast corner of North Point Boulevard and McPhillip Street. It was rezoned to C4 under DAS 10 of 2019. However, it sat vacant for a number of years. The proposed development is in a small portion of this property right at the corner, roughly 6.7 acres of the 18-acre parcel, overall parcel. It is within the recent community policy area of Complete Communities 2.0, and it's designated commercial mixed use under the North Point Village Local Area Plan, which is also known as Precinct F. So the proposed development is 6 commercial buildings clustered around a parking lot. The buildings would have a overall floor area of just over 75,000 square feet, and the parking lot would have 271 parking spaces. 5 of the commercial buildings would be commercial, just regular commercial buildings, and they can accommodate a variety of commercial uses. The 6th building is intended to host a financial institution. All of the buildings would have the entrances primarily oriented towards the parking area, which would be in the middle of the development. Some of the buildings would flank the public streets, McPhillips and North Point, and some would back onto the public streets. Worth noting that although they would be backing or flanking onto the streets, the development does have pedestrian access as a primary feature along both street frontages. There are 3 pedestrian access points. Of these, 2 on North Point Boulevard would include seating areas, as well as the one on McPhillips would also include a seating area. As well, the areas where the buildings are flanking the public street, the applicant has provided lots of glazing and glass windows, so there's ample transparency and views into the building from the sidewalk. In terms of the design, the buildings themselves will be a variety of white and gray shades of ephes, some stone masonry, some masonry on the brick, and red accent walls that would sort of tie the design of it all together. They are also proposing ornamental fencing along the street edges with some pillars. The style of the fencing and the pillars would match the development sign that is currently over there on the property. For garbage storage, they are proposing mulch bins, which are the underground earth bins. So they're below grade. And in terms of circulation and connectivity, as mentioned, there are prominent pedestrian connections to the sidewalks. As well as internally, all of the buildings connect to one another via pedestrian routes, and then there's one sort of main east-west pedestrian route that kind of acts as a pedestrian spine right in the middle of the development that just connects the far east and west side of the building or development site with one another. So overall, this is a unique commercial development, and it'll provide a variety of commercial amenities for neighborhood residents. It'll be accessible for those cycling or for otherwise coming to the development from the surrounding neighborhood, as well as for those driving by. So we're recommending approval and we're supportive.
Thank you, Mr. Hare. And we talked earlier about adding garbage receptacles to the seating areas. I think you have an amendment ready on that. And this is great. And again, very good collaboration on behalf of Landmark and the developer. in working with the public service, and as well, of course, reaching out to the community, residents, stakeholders, and also my office. So I'm in agreement with approving this, and we would like that amendment. Could you read that into the record?
Sure, Councillor, yes. So the amendment, based on the discussion earlier that I have prepared, is a condition of approval that trash receptacles be provided in locations near each of the proposed seating nodes, as shown on the proposed landscaping plan, to the satisfaction of the Director of Planning, Property and Development, and thereafter maintained to the satisfaction of the Director.
Okay. Now, should we or could we change that to garbage slash recycling? Because then it gives them some options. It'll be an and or.
So the term trash receptacle,
it encompasses all that?
Okay. Yeah. So it's just another way of saying exactly what you just said.
Excellent. Thank you. Well, that's good. And so I'll move that, move that we approve this plan approval with the amendment.
Do you want me to take that?
I just want to, sure, you can take the chair. And I just want to put some other comments on the record. As our planner pointed out, this is a new commercial development in the Old Caledonian Ward in our area. And more recently, we've seen commercial infill and redevelopment of existing sites, but this is new commercial development. So we have a responsibility, of course, to set the bar high, and this development achieves that. The seating areas and internal walkways that we see will make this an inviting development for neighborhood residents. And the high quality materials that we've seen on the plans, such as the brick, the stone, and red accent walls, will provide the development with unique and appealing commercial character. And again, that attention to detail, appreciate the landmark that worked with the planner and also the developer for putting those ideas forward. It's going to be a beautiful development, and that's what we want for our area. We don't want these things to just really happy with the high quality materials that have been presented. So this land has been zoned commercial, and it's been sitting vacant, as you know, for many years, and we've been wanting it to develop. So really excited about them coming forward at this time. And finally, with this proposed development, we're going to be adding 75,000 new square foot of new commercial floor area and provide commercial amenities for the neighborhood. It's building out. Aurora's almost fully built out. We've got a little bit to go. And then Highland Point's coming online, as we heard earlier today. So folks are waiting for these commercial amenities and looking forward to them. So thank you, everyone, for the hard work on this file. So with that, Madam Chair, I'll move approval of the plans as submitted with the one additional amendment on the trash receptacles.
Okay, all those in favor of the motion plus the amendment?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And that's carried unanimously. I'll pass the chair back to you.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
Item 4, plan approval, 2402 Ferrier Street. I'll go to the planner for summary.
Yes, Councillor. I'll keep this brief. So this is a proposed three-story multifamily building at 2402 Ferrier Street. It is on the west side of Ferrier, north of Templeton, south of Beecher. They are proposing 27 units at 45 parking stalls. The building would be roughly 36 and a half feet tall. It would be set back in the front on Ferrier by 20 feet. And as the applicant indicated, there would be an entry feature that would be 15 feet from the front yard. The main building would face the street. There would be accessible parking and pedestrian connections connecting the parking lot to the side entrances and the rear entrances as well. The plans are essentially a refined version of what was submitted with the rezoning application back in 2020. Prior to that formal rezoning application, they did submit a pre-app. We provided a number of comments in the pre-app. They took all those into consideration during the rezoning, and this is just a further refined version of what was approved under the rezoning. So we're supportive of the plans and are recommending approval.
Thank you, Mr. Herrick. And with that, Madam Councillor Santos, if you could take the chair.
Sure.
I'll move that the plans be approved as submitted, and I'll put a few things on the record here. This property, as we know it, is in an established neighborhood where our Winnipeg and complete communities direct access to increased housing options. This is a small-scale infill development that will be compatible with the surrounding area. The roof lines, as we see in the overall building design, will blend in well with the surrounding context, especially along Beecher. And we know there's multiple transit lines. They're all within a 10-minute walk of this property. So this is a very good location for multifamily housing. And with that, I move approval of the plans as submitted.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And that's carried unanimously.
Next is item 5, plan approval, 20 Link Street.
Do you want me to continue to take the chair?
Sure. To our planner, is there a summary?
It's a building committee and Councilor Sharma's board.
You're the chair, okay.
Yeah.
I thought you'd call on him.
Okay. Summary from the administration, please.
I'll give a brief summary, yes, councilors. So this is a property in Precinct G. It's at the southwest corner of Murray and Link Street in the West Kildonan Industrial Neighborhood of the old Kildonan Ward. It was rezoned under DSF 10 of 2019 to multifamily large. It's currently vacant and undeveloped, and they are proposing to construct 7 townhouse style buildings for a total of 54 units. The buildings would all have, each unit would have an attached garage with a front driveway that would be 20 feet long and provide access to the parking inside the attached garage. The applicant consulted with urban planning prior to submitting the application. We asked for a number of changes to the plan, which they've complied with all of our requests. We asked for a pedestrian route, linking all of the buildings to one another and linking to the public streets. We asked for the depth of the driveways to be at least 20 feet deep to accommodate parked vehicles, and they provided that as well. As well, we asked for them to propose a high-quality landscaping design along Link Street. They provided a decorative 4-foot-tall fence along links, as well as some trees and some shrubs. I will note that there is a condition of approval we are recommending on this plan approval. That's tied to a variance application that has also been applied for. So just to refresh everyone, the variance on this application, on this development, is a C-type application, a variance that typically would have gone to the Board of Adjustment. Those now go to the Director of Planning, Property and Development. Those variances have been approved and the site is currently posted. And so our condition of approval is that the plan approval comes into force when the variance also comes into force and clears the appeal period for that item. The variance is quite relatively minor. It's to permit the development to have the same dimensional standards as multifamily small. This property has multifamily large zoning, so that's the reason for the variance. So we did recommend and support and recommend approval of the variances. There would be a visitor parking area, 6 visitor parking spaces, 1 accessible stall. There would be a community mailbox and bike parking space near the visitor parking area. 2 approaches on Link Street, 1 approach to the public lane that's along the south side of the development. And overall, the buildings would use a mix of high quality materials that would blend well with the neighborhood. The development is consistent with the Precinct B secondary plan, both in terms of the density requirement as well as for the requirements for design. And we are recommending approval.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd like to move that we approve the plans as submitted. As we heard from Mr. Herrer, there's a need for this type of housing. Housing costs have been rising, but the need still exists. And I'm really happy about the internal walkways and visitor parking in the area. It'll be an inviting space for residents and visitors. Mm-hmm. And as was noted, this development is consistent with Precinct G secondary plan. I look forward to working with the applicant on adding a planter at the entrance of this multifamily housing project, and appreciate their collaboration with our planner and the conversations they've had with my office as well.
Okay.
So I'll move approval with the amendment to add the planter.
Would you like me to read that?
Yes, if you could read that into the record, please.
So based on the discussion from earlier, the recommended condition then would be that a planter be provided near the southerly private approach to the development site from Link Street to the satisfaction of the Director of Planning, Property and Development, and thereafter maintained to the satisfaction of the Director.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion amended as amended.
Mm-hmm.
All those in favor? Sorry.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. And that's carried. Yes.
I'll take the chair back. Councillor Santos, item 6 is extension of time, closing a public lane north of 341 Scotia Street between Scotia Street and the Red River. Mr. Herr, do you need to add something, or is that more land development branch?
We're on report 6.
Geometrics.
Yeah, that's your...
Kathy? Okay. Your Kathy Gagnon is with us from Geomatics Department. If there's anything you'd like to add or any particular questions we want to raise with her. Is Ms. Gagnon with us?
I'm here, Councillor.
Okay. Do you have your video on?
I thought I did. Let's try it again. There we go.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
So this is the 341 Scotia. So
yeah.
So I think the report recommends to allow the extension. I guess it got a little complex in how long it's taking because of there's different owners of the property, and I guess that's delayed some things.
Well, I'm not sure that that was the reason for the delay more than that in a normal course, field survey work would have been undertaken by now, but they can't because the river's still too high. So rather than risk not meeting the deadline for a bylaw to be enacted by council by July 23rd of 2022, they made the decision to apply for an extension to July 2023, just to make sure that they don't miss a crucial deadline and have to start from scratch.
Right. It'll be done before 2023.
More they more. Anticipate that, yes. If something happened that's unusual, like, you know, as it is this year, then they would still be required to make a further application to extend again. Yeah. But that would be, they would have to revisit what their reasons for any further delay. But right now, we're anticipating that by July 2023 or sooner, they'll get everything done.
Okay. Then, Madam Chair, I'm ready to move.
Okay.
Motion. Okay. I move that the Public Services recommendation to extend the time closing of Public Lane north of 341 Scotia Street between Scotia Street and the Red River.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary, that's carried. Item 7, proposed servicing agreement. Land located at 2091 Brookside Boulevard. Mr. Clerk, do we have the land development branch on the line with us?
We have Mr. Greg Jasper on the line. So Greg, if you want to start the video, unmute your mic.
Sorry about that.
Good afternoon, Greg.
So with respect to this, I think as Jeff noted, there's a question about the water supply and city policy and all that. And I want to apologize because I wasn't involved in the negotiations with the applicant on this. But listening to the applicants, he made a very compelling case on why a private water system should be used. I'd be hesitant to say that we should allow it now and wait for a report to say that it would work. And so what I would ask is if the committee would lay this over until the next meeting, and then I could sit down with the applicant and maybe we could come up with a solution that would be acceptable to both parties.
I like that, Madam Chair.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Any further questions? I'm amenable to that. And we'll lay over to the next meeting. If we happen to have a special meeting, Mr. Clerk, we could bring it forward there.
Yeah. Yes.
So, Councillor Eady, are you prepared to move layover to the next meeting?
Yes, I'll move layover to whatever next meeting of the Lord Selkirk West Donan Community Committee.
Yeah, to the next meeting. Okay, layover to the next meeting. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried.
Thank you.
Item 8, proposed servicing agreement. Mm-hmm. Land located at 20 Dunlop Avenue.
I don't think we had any.
Is Mr. Jasper familiar with this one?
This one.
Yeah, from a servicing point of view, we're looking for some sidewalks along Dunlop in front of the site and a widening of the right of way to accommodate.
Okay. I don't think we had any delegations on this.
No, we didn't.
And just for the committee notice, this was a short form application. So typically a short form application can be approved administratively unless there are servicing conditions that we want to put on it. And so therefore with a servicing condition, it has to be approved by council.
So did you work with the...
With our request to put in sidewalks, that becomes a servicing request, and so therefore council has to approve that.
Okay, and the developer's good with it?
Yep.
Okay.
Okay. All right, I'll move and support the Winnipeg Public Services recommendation for the proposed servicing agreement.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Item 9, nomination of the West Caledonian Library, 365 Jefferson Avenue, to the list of historical resources.
I think that in this report, it's the whereases are quite familiar. The community is quite interested in, and you know, I wasn't aware that the St. Patel Library, built near the same time, built by the same architect, had actually been a historical resource. So it's my honor to move this to P&D, who hopefully refers it to the Historical Buildings Committee for their consideration as to adding it to their resource list.
Thank you. Madam, I'm the chair right now.
You're still the chair.
Yeah. Councilor Eady, I want to thank you for your good work on this motion and the work of Daniel Gunther, resident in Garden City. And also we heard from Cindy Tugwell, who we all know is very passionate about heritage. So I appreciate, as we said earlier, the detailed presentation we received from Daniel Gunther. A lot of research went into that. And I think the PP&D committee will also appreciate reading that material. So I'm in full support of sending this forward. Mm-hmm. And then we'll hear from the Historical Resources Committee.
Yeah.
Thank you. Madam Clerk?
So I move the recommendation in the report.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Any new business? I don't believe there is any.
Oh, I move to suspend the rules to hear 3 per capita grant requests.
One 2 per capita grants and 1 license.
That,
yeah.
Okay.
What is that? That's a...
Okay. Suspension of the rules to hear 3 items. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Next, first item?
Item 10 is an occasional liquor permit for MEME 2022.
Yeah, we'll do that one first.
Yeah. Okay. I believe we had already... We're just here to ratify it. Yeah. I'll support to ratify this event. It's going to be held on June 25th, 2022.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Aye. That's carried.
I'll move. There's a per capita request from No Stone Unturned, who haven't had concert for some time. Their application is for a per capita grant of $1,000. The event is going to go ahead this year, barring no other problems at probably St. John's Park, my ward. So it's a good per capita, No Stone Unturned. All the funds they raise are put towards families who have missing and murdered women and family members. And it's a very important fundraiser that run by the MLA for Point Douglas, Ms. Bernadette Smith, and some other women trying to support the community.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Final item?
Okay. And it's a per capita grant for the Children's Heritage Fund going towards the Winnipeg School Division. Every year, my office assists in doing and handing out citizenship awards to graduating students of all 18 schools, but more particularly, the office likes to hand out bursaries. And so this is some funding that's going to help go towards the bursary for the Point Douglas Citizenship Award. So I'd like to support a per capita grant in the amount of $2,300, which to be funded from the Point Douglas Board allocation.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Councilor Eady, do you move adjournment?
I do move adjournment. Thank you for helping to expedite the meeting.
All in favor? Contrary? Carried. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.